Let's take up question. Now, guys, going forward, I am assuming that you guys will use this particular relation. Although you can solve the same question by just using total work done is equal to change in kinetic energy. You don't need this particular relation. But then since we have derived it, okay, and when it comes to spring, using this relation is easier than using work done is equal to K2 minus K1. So try to use this particular relation, get familiar to this, because you know, at times this will give you a quick answer. All right, so all of you draw this figure. There is a mass M like this. Spring with spring constant K is there. Okay. So mass M is released from the rest from a height H as shown in the figure. It slides and compresses the spring of stiffness K. You have to find the maximum compression in the spring. Okay, find out the maximum compression in the spring quickly. Root of 2 mgh by k. See, whenever you use work energy theorem, you are using it between the two points. Point number one and point number two. You can pick any of the two points. Fine. So I'll take the two points where the point number one is this, and point number two is where the spring get compressed maximum. Right. So spring will get compressed till the velocity of mass m goes to zero. Fine. So at the maximum compression, the velocity of mass m will become zero. Fine. So let's try to use this particular relation only. So work done is what? Zero. Gravity is doing the work, but that work you are considering it as a potential energy. Fine. And you're saying that this line could be the logical horizontal line for which you are assuming gravitational potential energy to be zero. Fine. So U1 is what? Initial potential energy will be equal to mgh. Fine. K1 is zero. It was at rest. Okay. Then U2 is what? Finally, the block comes to the level, horizontal level, where that is a level where you assume the gravitational potential to be zero. So this is zero. This is gravitational potential energy. But then there is a spring potential energy at point two. Initially, there was no spring potential energy. Now there is a spring also. So spring will gain a potential energy, half kx square. And we know that K2 is zero. So U2 has two potential energies, spring and gravity. So if you substitute it, you get 0 is equal to U2, which will come out to be half kx square. Gravitational potential energy is 0. So this plus K2 is 0 minus U1, which is mgh, plus K1, which is 0. Fine. So from here, you'll get the value of maximum compression in the spring, which will come out to be 2 mgh by k. Okay. Let's take up next question. You guys have any doubt on this particular question? Any one of you have any doubts? Sir, why is the work zero? See, who can do the work? Normal force doesn't do any work in this case, because normal force is always perpendicular to the displacement. It acts perpendicular to the surface. Fine. Gravity can do the work, but that work you are already factoring in a form of potential energy. So you can't factor in the work done by the gravity twice. Fine. So there is no other force. So only gravity is there. And when it compresses a spring, although spring also applies a force, but then even the spring force you are considering it as a potential energy. Fine, so no other force is left. That is why work done will be equal to zero, because this is the work done not by all the forces but by the other forces for which you have not considered the potential energy. See, now let me caution you. Okay, so there's a small caution here. Now what will happen is that you will develop your own version of conservation of energy. Okay, so you'll be like, if friction would have been there, then we would have considered it, right? Yes, you will consider the work done by friction if friction is there. Okay, so the caution is this, you should write it down, because this is something which destroys the chances to solve the question. Do not create your version of work energy theorem. That you should never ever do. If you start doing this, you'll be always confused. Okay, because I have seen students making version of the work energy theorem themselves. Like, they'll be like, okay, loss in potential energy will be equal to gain in kinetic energy, or loss in kinetic energy will be equal to gain in potential energy, or some random stuff. Okay, so do not put your brain in for creating a formula. Always fall back to this particular relation before every question. First write down this and just one by one find out the values, u2 k2 u1 k1 and work done by other forces. All of you clear about it? Do not create your version of work energy theorem. You may get some questions right, okay? You may get it right. I'm not saying you'll not get it right, but you'll confuse yourself and you'll never be confident. Okay, so let us move to next question. In case you have any doubts, feel free to message. You can message over WhatsApp, you can message on the chat, whatever you may feel comfortable. And I will not take your name. Another best part about the online class is that you can, secretly ask a doubt. You can be anonymous. So if you are feeling, conscious when you ask a doubt, you can freely text me your doubts. I was very conscious of asking doubts in a class. So I always used to keep quiet, and later on when everybody used to go, I used to ask. Anyways, so a block of mass M, okay, there is a block of mass M that strikes a light pan fitted with a vertical spring. So there's a small pan like this. It is a light pan, okay? It strikes a light pan fitted with a vertical spring after falling through a distance of h. So it falls a distance of h, then strikes this pan. Okay, if the stiffness of the spring is k, find the maximum compression in the spring. Get the value of maximum compression in the spring. Maximum compression in the spring, Sukirt. What is the maximum compression? No, Niranjan, that's not correct. So the one who has sent me the WhatsApp message, it was not correct. You can just take a pic of whatever answer you get and send me across. Should I do it? Those who are sending me answers over WhatsApp, please understand, I cannot chat with you. I can only look at what you are sending. Okay, so don't ask me questions on WhatsApp. That don't try to chat with me. Or you can post your doubts. That is fine. That I can address here, guys. See, this is the probably the initial phases of you learning the application of work energy theorem, right? So start the question by writing the, you know, formula itself. So always write this down and then start solving it, right? And when you write potential energy of the gravity, you need to understand what point you are taking zero potential energy. All right. No, till now nobody has sent me the correct answer. No. Good, many of you are sending me message. One of you sent me an imaginary answer, as in root over some negative quantity. That will be not correct, definitely. Who is this? Sukir, that's correct. Okay. Let's see how to solve this particular question. Maybe Bharat, you are doing some silly error. Probably the conceptually it may be correct, but then does it matter? So do it slowly and get it right the first time. Okay, till now only Sukirth has sent me the correct answer. Fine. Let me now solve this particular question. I want everybody to participate. See, you can clearly see that I have got at least 12 answers from people who have WhatsApped me, and only one was correct. So don't hesitate to answer. You can be wrong. Right now you can see that only one person was right and everybody else was wrong. So don't hesitate. Okay, let's try to solve this now. Let's assume that when it hits the spring gets compressed by a distance of x. So this is the maximum compression. Let's say x is a maximum compression. Fine. So I'll take my second point there only. This is my point number one, and point number two is the point where the spring get compressed maximum. All right. So what I'll do, I'll draw a horizontal line, and I'll say that the line that passes through the maximum compression point of the spring represents gravitation potential energy to be zero. Fine. So what does it mean? U2 automatically becomes zero, and U1 will be what? U1 will be equal to mg h plus x. I'm talking about gravitational potential energy. Fine. Many of you might not have taken x while finding the gravitational potential energy. Okay. The u2g and u1g. Now there is a spring potential energy finally. U2s is also there, which is half kx square. Okay. So what is left now? K1 is zero, right? Initially the object was at rest, and finally also it is zero. Now the one assumption we are making throughout. Can you guess what is the assumption we are making here? When we are applying this over here, the assumption we are making is that no energy is lost due to collision. Fine. If energy get lost due to collision, you cannot take point number one and point number two when the spring get compressed, because in between there is a collision. Okay. So there is no other force that is doing work other than gravity and spring, for which you have already considered the potential energy, right? So you'll get zero is equal to U2, which is a spring potential energy, that is half kx square, plus k2, which is zero, minus U1. Now, there is no spring potential energy initially, but there was gravitational potential energy. That is mg h plus x. Fine. Plus kinetic energy is 0. So you get a quadratic equation. Just solve this and you'll get the answer. Okay. The answer should be this. X will be equal to this is what you should get. Fine, so I hope it is clear. In case you have any doubt, please message immediately. Any doubts? So let us move to next question. Right, let us take up the next question. It refers to a figure, so let me draw the figure first. All of you, please draw it with me. This small m. This is the last question, then we'll take up another concept. So this is a scenario, okay? So two blocks of mass small m and capital M, they are placed like this. This is the ground. Okay, they're connected by a light spring of stiffness K. They're kept on a smooth horizontal surface as shown. What should be the initial compression of the spring? What you're doing is you're compressing this small m. Okay, what should be the initial compression of the spring so that system will be about to break off from the surface? So when you compress it, right? So suppose you compress it up to this level. Okay, and then you release it. So when you release it, okay, what happens? This block will try to move up because of spring force. Okay, and when it moves up, spring may get extended also. Fine. So you need to find out how much should be this compression in the spring, initial compression x naught, so that capital M can break off from the surface. So capital M, you need to find x naught. What is x naught for which capital M breaks off from the surface? Attempt it. Breaking of the surface means that capital M leaves the surface. Capital M jumps off. Should I do it? What is the condition for capital M to leave the surface? What is the condition? All of you. Normal force to be zero. Okay. Now if it is placed just like that, normal force will never be equal to zero because there is a gravitational force acting on it. Which is mg. And since it is not accelerating, there has to be a normal force which is equal to mg. Fine. But what if there is a spring force upwards, which is, let's say, kx1. And then if you balance out the forces, write kx1 plus n minus mg, then this is equal to zero. You'll get condition when normal force becomes zero. So normal force becomes zero when extension in the spring becomes equal to capital Mg by K. This should happen, then only it will leave the surface. Okay, let me call it as X2. Initially it was X1, let us say. Fine. Now try to do this. Which chapter from book 1 is going on in school? No, that is not correct. You need not know the spring length. Okay, because that doesn't matter. Spring constant is given, so deviation from the length of the spring is what determines the thing. Okay, so we are at par with whatever is going on in school. I have received another answer. See, there will be initial compression already in the spring. You need to find out further how much you need to compress it. Okay, now let me do this. I'll do this now. Okay, so let us say that when it is kept at rest, the spring has some compression, right? Let us say X naught was an initial compression, which is Mg by K. Okay, this much compression will be already there because small m is a, m is sitting at the top of the spring. Okay, now let us say that you have further compressed it by a distance of X1. Okay, and then released it. So what will happen now is that from a compression of X naught plus X1, it should go to extension of X2. Then only capital M will be able to jump off. Okay, so this is our initial point. This is our initial point and this is our final point. So between these two points, I'm going to apply work energy theorem. Fine. Let me take up another color pen. I'm using only yellow and white. How is this? This is nice. Okay. So, right. Fine, so I'm going to first write down work energy theorem. Work done is U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Now you'll see that only gravity and spring forces are there, and both of them you are considering potential energy. So this left hand side becomes zero. Okay, so W is zero. U2 is what? The final final potential energy. So U2 will have gravitational potential energy, let's say U2G, and it will have a spring potential energy, U2S. Fine. So we need to first assume what is a zero gravitational potential energy. So we can assume that the level where it is initially compressed, that is the gravitational potential energy to be zero. Fine. So I can say that initial gravitational potential energy is zero. Fine. So final gravitational potential energy will be what? Mg into X naught plus X1 plus X2. Because X1 is compression. So from this much down, it should go that much up. It should get extended, the spring. So total height from this zero potential energy line will be X naught plus X1 plus X2. Okay, I hope it is clear. In case not, please message. Final spring potential energy will be half K times x2 square, because x2 is the extension in the spring now. All right. And then I need to quickly find out initial gravitation potential G, which is zero, because that's where you have assumed the gravitation potential G to be zero. And initial spring potential energy is half k times what? Half k into what square? X naught plus x1 square, guys. Okay, u2g. See, I have assumed this line to be zero gravitation potential energy. This is the line initially the block was in, and right now block is compressed. Okay, so this is initial position. Now finally what should happen? Finally the spring should get extended by x2. Right now it is compressed. Compressed by how much? X0 plus x1. So it should move up by x0 plus x1 and then further go up by x2. So if it moves up by x0 plus x1, it will go to the natural length, and then it should go to x2 further up. Okay, so that's how you get gravitation potential energy, as half x0 plus x1 plus x2. Sorry, mg into x0 plus x1 plus x2. That is gravitation potential energy, and spring potential energy is nothing but half k into whatever extension or compression square. Is it clear now? So this is u1s, okay, and w is zero. So just substitute, this is u2, sum of gravitation potential energy finally plus spring potential energy, and this is u1, sum of gravitation and spring potential energy. And anyways, since we are finding the minimum compression, initial kinetic energy will be zero, and final also I am taking it to be zero. Is it clear, all of you? It was not a very straightforward question, but I thought of taking it up. Is it clear? Kindly message yes or no if you have any doubts. Any doubts? What break, Niranjan? Are you not enjoying it? We'll see, Ashutosh. We'll see.